tickets, even a new car. You can play this amazing sports app by yourself, with your friends, or even with a large group of fans from all over the world. This incredible sports app is called FireFan, and it's available right now. Check it out. Sign up today at www.freefirefanapp.com.
California Redwood Gazebos reminds everyone that one of the keys to locating missing children is getting current information into the hands of the proper authorities. Keep recent photos and always remember what they are wearing. Have your children fingerprinted at an early age, because kids change, but fingerprints don't. This reminder from California Redwood Gazebos, serving the community with pride for over 42 years with an A-plus rating with the BBB. For quality gazebos and patios for your backyard, pool, or outdoor kitchen, call 951-233-2004. That's 951-233-2004, and like them on Facebook.
Disney on Ice presents Dream Big. Join Cinderella, Rapunzel, Ariel, and more Disney princesses as they let courage lead the way. Then discover true love with Anna, Elsa, and Olaf from Disney's Frozen. Adventure is waiting for your family.
Opening night tickets start at $15. Restrictions and additional charges may apply. Playing at Long Beach Arena April 20th through 23rd and at Citizens Business Bank Arena April 27th through 30th. For tickets, visit DisneyOnIce.com today.
This is KCAA.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the DRC Wealth Manager's Hour on KCAA 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and 102.3 FM. I am Bobby Cherry. I am your host this afternoon. Thank you for joining us for another adventurous hour as we spend reviewing the markets. And we have our guest this afternoon, which we'll be introducing shortly. We have Rodney J. Hatley of the Hatley Law Group out of San Diego. He'll be joining us momentarily after I catch you up on what I'm watching this week and a little forecast of what we're expecting this week. So let's get started, shall we? For the markets, as of April 14th, 2017, a long weekend filled with global tensions from the Middle East to North Korea is giving way to uncertainty over French elections, which start this coming Sunday. With the United States and many global markets closed for Good Friday, stocks ended the short trading week lower. Trading volumes are low for much of the week, as investors may be concerned with rising tensions overseas in Syria and North Korea, and the continuation of strained diplomatic relations with Russia. Of the U.S. indexes, only the Dow Jones losses were under 1%. On the other hand, the Russell 2000 and the NASDAQ suffered the largest dips, falling 1.42% and 1.24% respectively. The price of crude oil increased last week, closing at $52.91 per barrel, up from the prior week's closing price of $52.29 per barrel. The price of gold continued to climb, closing at $1,290.10 by late Friday afternoon, up from the prior week's price of $1,256.10. The national average retail gasoline price increased to $2.36 per gallon on April 3rd, 2017, 0.045 cents higher than the prior week's price of 0.227 more than a year ago. Big speculators were again big sellers in crops and livestock last week, increasing their bearish bets by more than 50% by selling 75,000 net contracts. Hedge fund short positions in most of the year, with only cattle complex seeing buying. Index traders were only lightly sellers, taking another 1,500 contracts off their position. Also in play this week are May options, which expire on Friday. Overseas, the markets in China sold off despite news of stronger growth, with mixed trade in the rest of Asia. U.S. stock indexes are trying to turn higher, with the dollar a bit weaker, lending support to safe haven buying in gold and in treasuries. Our fixed income outlook. Subdued inflation should help keep interest rates relatively low, and we expect them to rise slowly and modestly. Long-term interest rates have been rising since last summer, following more than 35 years of generally declining rates. Historically, the rates on fixed income investments have been lower when rates are generally rising, while improving economic growth has prompted the Federal Reserve to increase the frequency of short-term rate hikes. the Fed will likely continue moving slowly and cautiously as long as inflation doesn't rise sharply. While interest rates have remained low, spreads on the high-yield bonds have shrunk. We think investors should reduce their allocations to aggressive income and international fixed income investments if needed, adding cash as well as short and intermediate term investment grade bonds where appropriate. On the international outlook, international equity investments outperformed U.S. stocks in the first quarter of 2017. As global growth improved, foreign earnings rebounded, and the value of the U.S. dollar stabilized. Brighter prospects from global growth should continue to support rising international stock prices over time. International rates have fallen, manufacturing output has risen, and consumer confidence has improved in Europe, Japan, and other areas. And expansionary monetary policies, monetary policies in many developed countries continue to help growth by keeping interest rates below U.S. reach, which we think will rise slowly. We recommend adding broad-based international developed market investments because they're more actively valued and higher dividend yields and higher expected earnings growth rates than large U.S. cap stocks. Emerging markets also outperformed in the first quarter. We think a small allocation is appropriate, as their higher expected returns appear to reflect their higher risk. Outlook on long-term economic growth. The potential growth rate of the economy over time and a growth measure of economic health. It is a key driver of expected earnings growth and indirectly equity returns. Worker growth rates are projected to be lower over the next decade, both in the U.S. and abroad, due to demographic shifts which result in lower potential economic growth. Investors should prepare for possibly lower average returns in the future with the strategy to invest more and or spend less. In last week's headlines, inflation, which had been trending upward, took a somewhat unexpected reversal of course in March as the Consumer's Price Index fell 0.3% from the prior month. Over the last 12 months, the CPI rose 2.4% compared to a 2.7% gain for the 12 months ended in February. The March decline was the first monthly decrease since February 2016. A decline in gasoline prices was the largest factor contributing to the drop in prices. But even excluding food and energy, the CPI fell 0.1% for the month and is up 2% over the last 12 months compared to a gain of 2.2% for the last 12 months ended in February. Core prices haven't fallen since February 2010. The producer price index fell 0.1% in March, following increases of 0.3% in February and 0.6% in January. The index rose 2.3% in the 12 months ended March 2017, the largest increase since moving up 2.4% for the 12 months ended March 2012. For the 10th straight month, prices less food, energy, and trade services edged up 0.1% and have climbed 1.7% for the 12 months ended in March 2017. Retail sales decreased 0.2% in March, falling for the second straight month. February sales were revised to a 0.3% decrease, which represented the largest 2 months fall in retail sales since January and February of 2015. Job openings increased in February, while the number of new hires dropped, an indication that employers may be having a hard time fulfilling positions. According to the latest job openings and labor turnover summary, there were 5.743 million job openings in February compared to 5.625 million job openings in January. The numbers of hires fell, moving from 5.424 million hires in January to 5.341 million hires in February. Total separations, which includes quits, layoffs, and discharges, also dropped in February, which saw a 5.071 million separation compared to a 5.24 million the prior month. Job openings increased in healthcare and social assistance, accommodation and food services, and finance and insurances. Hires increased in retail, trade, and mining and logging, but decreased in federal government. Over the 12 months ended in February, hires totaled 63 million and separations totaled 60.6 million, yielding a net employment gain of 2.24 million. Driven by lower fuel prices, U.S. import prices declined 0.2% in March, according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics. Over the past 12 months ended in March, import prices have advanced 4.2%. The price index for import fuel declined 3.8% in March, the largest one-month drop since the index fell 6.8% in February 2016. In contrast to fuel prices, non-fuel import prices increased in March, rising 0.2%, following a 0.4% increase in February. The price index for non-fuel imports advanced 1% over the past 12 months, the largest 12-month advance increase since the index increased 1.3% in April of 2012. Export prices increased 0.2% for the month after advancing 0.3% in February. U.S. export prices also increased over the past year, rising 3.6% for the year ended in March. That matched the 12-month advance record for the December 2011 and was the largest 12-month increase since the index rose 4.8% in November 2011. The government deficit fell in March to $176.2 billion, down from February's $1.92 billion. Year-to-date, the deficit sits at $526.9 billion, which is $67.5 billion more than the deficit over the same period last year. In the week ended April 8, the advance figure for seasonal adjusted initial claims for unemployment was 234,000, a decrease of 1,000 from the previous week's revised level. The previous week's level was revised up by 1,000 to 235,000. The advance seasonally adjusted insured unemployment rate remained at 1.5%. The advance number for seasonally adjusted insured unemployed during the week ended April 8 was 2,228,000, a decrease of 7,000 from the previous week's revised levels. Eye on the week ahead. The housing sector has been volatile, with existing home sales lagging while sales of new homes have surged. Equities look to recover following last week's dip. And there you have it, my statement of what I'm watching this week and my outlook going into next week. We'll be right back as we jump to a quick commercial, and we'll be joined with our guest, Mr. Rodney Hatley of the Hatley Law Group.
Stop me on the corner, swear you hit me like a vision.
KCAA is your CNBC news affiliate. We're the station that gets down to business.
Like to spend a few days in another world? Then write this down. Golden Bear Cottages, Big Bear Lake. Now, listen, this is not some corporate-owned operation. It's family-owned and operated by some real nice people. Unique? Oh, you bet. Golden Bear Cottages features 28 one-of-a-kind cabins on a 5-acre historic site. Great for families, couples, and groups. And cabins are available with 1 to 7 bedrooms. Golden Bear Cottages is just a stone's throw from Big Bear Lake and super close to 3 great ski areas. Now, I could go on all day about Golden Bear Cottages in Big Bear, but to see everything, just go to goldenbear.net. Again, goldenbear.net. Golden Bear Cottages in Big Bear. Clean, comfortable, and affordable. Check them out. goldenbear.net.
Redlands Blueprint and Commercial Printing Company has been serving the greater Inland Empire for over 60 years. For all of your printing needs, from full-color printing to high-speed copying and everything in between, go to Redlands Blueprint and Commercial Printing Company. Their staff is committed to your total satisfaction. Great service isn't just lip service at Redlands Blueprint and Commercial Printing Company. It's the way they do business year after year. Having trouble finding drafting supplies? Redlands Blueprint and Commercial Printing Company still carries a complete selection. Redlands Blueprint and Commercial Printing Company is rated high in customer satisfaction by ValueStar, an independent rating company. For all of your personal or business printing, call Redlands Blueprint and Commercial Printing Company at 909-792-3478. That's 792-3478, or visit them on New York Street in Redlands off the I-10 and the Crosstown Freeway.
KCAA.
Good afternoon again. This is Bobby Cherry with the DRC Wealth Management Hour. My name is Bobby Cherry, and tonight's guest is Mr. Rodney Hatley from the Hatley Law Group. How are you today, Rod? Can everyone hear Rod out there? Can you speak up, Rod, or can you?
Yeah.
Okay, there you go. There you go.
Yeah, sorry about that.
That's quite all right. Well, thank you again, Rod, for joining us.
Pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
My absolute pleasure. Full transparency, Rod and I have worked together, and I've known him for a number of years. He's down there in San Diego, my hometown. I'm a little jealous that he's in San Diego today and I'm not.
Yeah.
So Rod, since this is your first time with us today, could you give us a little information about yourself, your firm, and what it is that you all do?
Okay. Yeah. Well, thank you for asking. I'm a former Navy JAG attorney. So you ever saw the movie A Few Good Men? That's what I used to do years ago. And about 25 years ago, my father passed away. Dad had leukemia, and I knew that Dad needed to do more planning. But because he was sick, it was pretty evident that he was making emotional decisions at that point instead of rational decisions, and it's totally understandable. Long story short, he dies in June of 92. I take emergency leave. I go back to my hometown of Memphis, Tennessee. And week number one, we get Dad buried. Week number two, we visit with Dad's business attorney to undertake to do a probate, since all Dad had was a simple will. Wills go through probate, and probate takes time, it costs money, and it's a matter of public record. In our case, because Dad had various business interests that had not been sufficiently provided for, what happened was we endured a 7-year probate back in Memphis. Now, that's not what Dad wanted, but that's what we got, because he simply could not do more and better planning as a result of having being so sick with leukemia. So at that time, I decided, you know, I really have enjoyed trial work, and representing the accused at courts martial has been, you know, a wonderful learning experience, but I was always in a reactive mode. So I wanted to get smarter about tax law. So when I came off of active duty in 95, I moved to San Diego. I was never stationed here. I was stationed in the high desert of California. Came to San Diego, got an advanced law degree in taxation, and then I shifted my focus into the area of estate planning, trust, and probate law. Because I didn't want another client to have to go through what my sister and I had to endure with a multi-year probate after Dad passed away. So that's really been the focus of my practice since 1996. So anyway, that's really kind of when I undertake to do estate planning for my clients, it's not just an intellectual exercise for me. It's real-world stuff. So I tell people, with me, it's personal. And my clients aren't allowed to put their families through probate if I have anything to say about it.
Fantastic. Well, I know many times, especially in our profession, myself as a financial advisor and yours as an estate planning attorney, we're asked a lot of times after the fact about decisions that have already been made, trusts that have already been executed, insurance that's already been issued, and issues like that. And I'm sure based on our mutual collective experiences over the years, we could devise an extensive list of planning mistakes that we've commonly seen. And in our conversation today, I've kind of done that for you and for the listeners today, to just kind of touch on what I would call 10 of my top 10 planning mistakes.
Okay.
And as you mentioned, kind of with your father and the simple will that he had, number 10 on my list is ineffective beneficiary designations. Would you to expand on that?
Yeah, you know, what happens, and it's absolutely crucial that people get this right. Typically what happens is, in the more typical scenario that you'll see is a married couple. They get divorced, and the husband, let's say, he has a life insurance policy on his life. He's the breadwinner, and he moves on to wife number two, but he never updated the beneficiary designation of his life insurance from wife number one to wife number two. Now he passes away for whatever reason, injury, disease, what have you. And now the wife number one, or former wife number one, is the one who gets the proceeds, the insurance proceeds. Why? Well, by operation of law, it goes by contract. Even though he was married to wife number two, because he had never taken the additional step of updating the beneficiary designation for his life insurance, the new wife is the beneficiary of those proceeds. And you'll also see this too with, like, say, retirement plan monies, maybe an IRA, 403B, 401K, stuff like that. People just forget, you know, they're so relieved that they finally got divorced, but they forgot to go the extra step of removing the former spouse and adding the new spouse to the beneficiary designation.
In regards to a minor that That's the intended beneficiary.
Yeah.
The use of the Uniform Transfer Minors Act, is that something that you would recommend and something you'd...
Well, sure, yeah. I mean, I think they don't get it until age 23 is my recollection. Mm-hmm. I don't see a lot of that in my practice, but I know a lot of people will use them. But I don't encounter those very much in my practice. But certainly it's a way to say that... And actually, I think it can even be later than that. I think I just worked on a probate case where the money was going to be held in a California Uniform Transfers to Minors Act, or a CUTMA, account until age 25. And one of the beneficiaries will be 25 later this year, so that money will be held in a CUTMA account until he turns 25. So it's a great way to hold that money for the benefit of a minor, or in this case, he's certainly an adult because you're an adult at age 18. But it's a great way to hold that money aside for the benefit of the beneficiary until they reach a stated age. And in this particular case, it turned out to be 25. So those can be good planning devices. But, you know, it needs to be part of an overall concerted, coordinated plan with your not only your financial advisor, but ideally, if you have an estate planning attorney, those two people are talking to each other, and if you also maybe have a CPA, he or she, you know, is part of that virtual team too, if you will.
Okay. Again, ladies and gentlemen, we're speaking with Mr. Rod Hatley from the Hatley Law Group. Rod, if you could, please give the audience your website and your phone number, just in case there's somebody out there that wants to touch base with you sidebar.
Yeah, happy to have an opportunity to connect with any of your listeners here. My web address is www.hatleylawgroup.com, hatleylawgroup.com. And if you want to speak to me by phone, certainly feel free to give me a call. Area code 858-792-3444, 858-792-3444.
Okay. And going back on our conversation on the beneficiary designations, in regards to trusts or estates named, and they're naming the beneficiary, as the beneficiary from an IRA or a 401k. Can you expound a little bit on the trouble situation you may occur with that?
Well, I mean, you know, it's important to, you know, let's say a client comes in and just so that you know my bias, I think most people, if they own real property here in California, are probably going to be better served by having a living trust. Assets that are owned by the trust never go through probate. And having gone through a 7-year probate, when my father passed away, it's so easy to avoid that if the clients and I can have a chance to talk about it and get out ahead of the issues, or get out ahead of the issues. If a client has a living trust, the way I draft my trust, they certainly can make their living trust the primary beneficiary of a retirement plan, whether it's an IRA, a 401k, 403b, that sort of thing. It has to have certain special provisions in it. And because the trust is a revocable trust, you know, in other words, you could revoke it, you can amend it, that sort of thing. If the trust should ever go away someday, we would then say, well, if the trust is ever revoked, we would put, or we'd recommend, put the surviving spouse as the secondary beneficiary of the retirement plan money. So in my practice, if I do a living trust for clients, I'll do make a recommendation that we make the trust as the primary beneficiary, and the surviving spouse, if there is one, or children, if there is no surviving spouse, the secondary or contingent beneficiary of the retirement plan monies.
Thank you. Okay, number 9 on my list is the... is the improper individual ownership of life insurance policy. Again, full transparency, I am a licensed insurance advisor, insurance agent in a number of states, just for transparency's sake. But on this question, this is primarily geared for estate planning. To avoid the inclusion of a death benefit in the insured's estate and the cost.
A lot of it's going to depend on where the clients are. I mean, right now, as I like to describe it, everybody has in their hip pocket, whether they realize it or not, a coupon, if you will, for up to $5.49 million. So I can leave that amount of money estate tax-free, and every dollar over that would be taxed at a 40% clip, so 40 cents out of every dollar over the $5.49 million would go off to Uncle Sam. And if it's a married couple, we just put the two coupons together. So they can shelter $10.98 million or an eyelash under $11 million before there would be any estate tax impact. If the clients are have less than $11 million of net worth, okay, or less than $5.49 million if it's a single individual, there probably isn't as big a concern for life insurance. Although I would say, if you have life insurance, possibly to provide for minor children, or if there's if you're married and have a surviving spouse, you want to, you know, educate the kids, get them, raise the kids, and then have something left over for your surviving spouse to have something of a nest egg later on. I think it's perfectly acceptable to make the primary beneficiary of the life insurance proceeds the living trust if we've done one. But as the client's net worth may either exceed the $5.49 million or the $10.98 million if it's a married couple, we probably then ought to be taking a look at doing an irrevocable life insurance trust. Sometimes it's called an ILIT. That's the acronym, I-L-I-T. And so, you know, because that would otherwise be pulled into the estate and you would be taxed on those proceeds. Here's the key distinction to keep in mind. Life insurance is income tax-free, but it may not be estate tax-free depending on how large the client's estates are. So if it's less than $5.49 million for a single person or $10.98 million for a married couple, then life insurance is part of the estate. We don't really need to worry about that being taxed in the estate because there's not going to be an estate tax concern. And I would just make it payable primarily to the living trust. And then secondarily, if the trust had ever, you know, was ever revoked, then make it payable to the surviving spouse or to the children if there is no surviving spouse. But as the net worth of the clients goes up, then I would probably recommend, you know, let's take a look at doing an irrevocable life insurance trust because we want to get that life insurance, get those life insurance proceeds out of your estate so they're not included for estate tax purposes. And so therefore, what we've done in that kind of situation is not only are the proceeds going to be income tax free to the ultimate beneficiaries, possibly children, but they'll also be estate tax free too. So there won't be a 40% that has to go off to Uncle Sam after the death of the insured.
Okay. And utilizing the ILT, would that also help the family? Would that help the family avoid out of order deaths or creditor harassment, perhaps, or even unintended gifting?
Yeah, I mean, because it's an irrevocable trust, I mean, it is. It's going to be protected from, as I like to say, creditors and predators. Creditors and somebody who sues the in my parlance or my lingo, I call the person who creates a trust the trust maker. So if the trust maker, let's say we set up an ILIT, the trust maker gets sued, well, the creditor is not going to get those assets or those proceeds. And then if there's a divorce or a remarriage or what have you, more than likely or there's a divorcing spouse, that divorcing spouse is not going to be able to get access to those life insurance proceeds in the ILIT. So I call those people predators, you know, the outlaws. So anyway, everything's going to be driven certainly by the specific facts of each case. But I think generally speaking, if we're not worried about an estate tax impact, having the life insurance payable to the living trust, I think, is fine. If we're over the coupon amount, either for a single person or a married couple, then we ought to be taking a look at doing an ILIT and creditor protect those proceeds and also creditor protect them as well.
Okay. Number eight, and this actually leads right into my number eight, ignoring the formalities of the trust. As beneficiaries, and I'm sure you can go more on this because you've done this more than I do, but actually let's just like that. As is common with most ILITs, the grantor annually contributes some or all the money needed to pay the premium on the life insurance policy owned by the trust and wishes to have that contribution qualify as an annual exclusion gift.
Okay.
Can you touch on the crummy powers?
Yeah. And it almost sounds kind of funny, you know, why would I want crummy powers? I mean, wouldn't I want something that's just better than crummy. Actually, the crummy that we're talking about was a Dr. Crummy, and that comes from the case of Crummy versus the Commissioner of Internal Revenue. That's a tax court case from years ago. And what happened was Dr. Crummy had made various gifts using the annual gift tax exclusion, which these days is $14,000 per year per person. So the IRS was contending, well, you know, he made this money available to pay the life insurance premiums. He made this available for, you know, 30 days, and then it terminated. And we don't think that that's, you know, appropriate. I mean, you shouldn't put a time limit on it. They said it was just an illusory gift. And what Dr. Crummy's attorneys were able to do, and they argued to the tax court successfully, they said, well, it's a gift of a present interest, okay? In other words, they have the beneficiaries of a life insurance policy or a life insurance trust, I should say, have the right to withdraw money that's put on deposit in the bank for them to pay the premiums. And if after the end of 30 days, they haven't exercised their withdrawal right, or sometimes called the crummy right, to withdraw that money, then that money will then be sent by the trustee of the islet, and it'll be sent off to pay the insurance premiums to the insurance company. So to recap very quickly, you can give up to $14,000 a year to anybody, and if there's a spouse, you can sometimes what they call gift split. So each of the husband and the wife can give $14,000 to their children, spouses of children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. All these things can be done, and it just again, it just depends on the circumstances and who we're planning for and what are the concerns. But up to $14,000 per year per person, and you know, depending on how large the policy is and what the premiums are, that may well cover all of the premium that has to be paid that particular year. So, you know, but work with your attorney, make sure that you're doing this correctly, and you know, many times, now clients, when they set up an ILA, they will be the trust makers, of course. They can't be the trustees because that's too much control. So an accountant or a CPA can be a very good choice to serve as the trustee of an islet, because it's very deadline driven, and that's what accountants are good at. They're good at meeting the deadlines for their clients. So that's something to keep in mind. Does that help?
Absolutely, it does. I think that gives us a lot of clarity. Next on my list, and this is kind of just it doesn't really have a really succinct answer, because again, you know, we'll see how your answer is. But sure. For myself, and this is something I talk to my clients before I refer them to an individual like yourself or your firm, is the failure to do business succession planning. Can't really state this enough. A lot of business owners I come across, they do in fact have a life insurance policy for themselves.
Sure.
They may even have a retirement plan in place for themselves and their employees. But they really haven't put down pen to paper or even thought process about the business succession.
Oh, sure. Yeah, it's very important. I mean, you shouldn't. I mean, if you're a business owner, and I know you have plenty of listeners on the call today or on the show today, are business owners of one stripe or another, and you know it's important to make provisions not only for yourself and your family, but also, and so have your personal planning done, but also have your business succession plan, thought through. I actually, this is hard to believe, but I actually had a client years ago tell me he wanted to die at his desk with his boots on. And I said, well, are you sure that you want to do it that way? I mean, there are other ways we could do this. I mean, if I had some ideas for how we might, if I had other options for you, would you want to hear them, or should I just keep it to myself? So we actually got him to consider additional ways to transfer or transition the business from him to a key employee, or if the kids are interested in the business, to transfer it down to them, but still, you know, retain some control so the kids don't go crazy and run the business into the ground. So you know, it's absolutely essential if you want to be successful with your business. And I know many of the business owners that are listening in right now, many of them have done fabulously well, and that's to be commended. But if you haven't had a chance to sit down with someone, you know, like Bobby or any other good financial advisor, you know, let me encourage you, please do that, because you're going to make a real difference for your employees and for your family later on when something happens to you. Now, I mean, ideally, you know, you're going to have long, happy, healthy lives and see grandchildren and great-grandchildren, et cetera. But the reality is tomorrow is promised to no one. So I encourage people, if you've got some planning done, congratulations. If you haven't done any planning for your business, you know, you take this as a wake-up call. You know, please do something. Meet with an advisor. Find out what your options are. And then make an informed choice as to what you want to do. Because, you know, life has a way of happening to you. And if you're not planning ahead, you are leaving things to chance. Now, you know, so that you know, I mean, the state of California has written a plan for you. It's the default plan, and it may not be the plan that you want for yourself and for your family and for your employees. So, you know, if you want to change the way things would go, you know, work with people like Bobby, work with people like me, find a good accountant who deals with businesses or small business owners, and, you know, get your affairs in order, because, you know, that's the only way to guarantee that, you know, you're going to have a better result than if you didn't do so.
Absolutely. Well, you'd briefly touched on it, and we'll dive into it now that it is basically tax season. And,
yeah.
You know, tax laws hasn't changed that much this year, but I'm sure for 2017 going forward, we're going to see some changes with the new administration. In that regard, planning only to address the gift and the estate tax laws is a bit of a fallacy, wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, it is. I mean, so many of the tax law changes that were embodied in the proposed repeal of Obamacare, because they actually withdrew the legislation to repeal Obamacare. My best guess, and from the people that I, you know, talk to, my colleagues who are in the know, they suspect that we won't see any meaningful tax reform until next year at the earliest. And we still have an estate tax right now, and so that you know, the estate tax has been repealed 13 times and enacted 14 times. So, I mean, I think we're always going to have one of one stripe or another. I think, though, the important thing to do is, you know, this is the law as we know it now. And we can't plan for the law as we hope it will be or we think it will be. We plan for the law as we know it now. And we try to build in as much flexibility. Even though life insurance trusts are irrevocable, we can build in the ability to change things if we need to, because the laws change or circumstances change, stuff like that. So I think the important thing is get planning in place, make sure that it's flexible to take care of not only your personal situation, but the tax laws as they will change, and I'm sure they will at some point when we don't know.
Absolutely.
And having that kind of flexibility is really key to providing you know, some peace of mind for clients.
Fantastic. Thank you. That's very well stated, Rod. Thank you. Continuing further down my list, and we haven't really touched on charitable planning, nor the the complexities of charitable planning. And I know with a firm that I had worked with before that was primarily a tax shop, charitable planning was a significant part of how they did business.
Okay.
One thing that I would notice is a lot of the clients, and there were a significant number of high net worth clients, to be honest there, but a lot of them, they really underappreciated charitable planning. And and let's spend a couple minutes just on talking about charitable planning and also the complexities of it.
Sure. You know, I mean, I always tell clients this, especially if they're wealthy clients, and they don't have to be wealthy, certainly. But I mean, for the more typical situation is you've got a client who, you know, maybe is looking at potentially an estate tax impact to either his or her estate if it's a single person, or if it's a married couple, their estate. I say, you know, if you had three potential beneficiaries, one was your family. Another was a charity near and dear to your heart, and the third was Uncle Sam, and you could only give to two of those three, which one would you want to disinherit? It would probably be, by and large, Uncle Sam, because And always remember this too, you know, especially when we talk about state taxes, that's a tax on already once taxed money. So that's another bite at the apple. So sometimes they call the estate tax a death tax. And the question often is asked of me, well, why do we have a death tax? And I facetiously say, well, because dead people don't vote. So, I mean, I think we have to, you know, get smart about what the options are. So if you can benefit your family and you can benefit a charity, I think that's much better than benefiting Uncle Sam. So if we want to benefit a charity, we can definitely do that. And we have to, you know, say, well, maybe we should consider setting up a charitable remainder trust. Sometimes I call that a CRT. And the idea behind it is if you have low basis stock, maybe say you founded a company years ago, and the basis or whatever you have invested in the stock is very, very low. But if you were to sell that company today, you'd get killed on the capital gains taxes because you've got a very low basis but a very high fair market value. It's the difference between those two numbers that is the capital gain tax. So what can be done is we can actually sell the company to a charitable remainder trust. And, you know, you put it, you transfer it in there, it's sold, you get a goose egg for the capital gains tax, and then you as the trust maker of the CRT, you get an income stream for, you know, either a stated term of years or for the rest of your life. And if the clients are healthy enough that they can be insured, what we can do is take that increased cash flow and use it to pay for life insurance. And so what you'll often see, especially if we're dealing with a charitable remainder trust, you'll see an ILIP paired with it. So the idea is, well, if we're going to give away an asset, okay, and that asset's going to be sold inside the charitable remainder trust so that we can get rid of the capital gains taxes, well, that's great, but what did we just do? We gave away or we donated an asset, a large asset of the family to the CRT. But if we compare that with an irrevocable life insurance trust, so now the increased cash flow that you're getting because you get this charitable tax deduction, you know, should be able to provide for paying the life insurance premiums of an ILIP. And so now you get to have your cake and eat it too. You gave away one asset, put it into a CRT, but that gave you increased cash flow so that you could then fund a life insurance policy and fund an ILIP. And so when you die someday, you basically get that money back in the form of the proceeds from the life insurance trust. So it's a great way to, you know, have your cake and eat it too. Now, you know, certainly you want to talk to your advisors. Don't just run off and do this. And the thing that scares me the most is people who want to do this online. Look, you know, you don't know what you don't know about the law, okay? I always tell people, look, you know, I'm waiting for WebMD to come out with the home surgery kit. You know, is that appendix bothering you? Just take it right out. I think it's really important, you know, work with qualified professionals, people who have done this for a living, and they do it all the time, and work with them and make sure that you're getting the very best counsel, not only from the legal standpoint, the attorneys who would do this, but also from your accountant and your financial advisor. All these folks should be talking to each other. Because I think that's really key, because I think if there's that kind of great coordination between the three, that'll make a real difference, and there won't be opportunities that are missed, because somebody once asked me, you know, can you give me an example of what the power of collaboration, I thought for a moment, I said, I can tell you exactly what it's like. When I collaborate, Bobby, let's say that you and I are working on a case, the power of our collaboration would be the power of one and one. Not what's the sum of one and one. We know that that's two. But what's the power of one and one? Well, that's 11. So that's pretty phenomenal. You know, you see an exponential rise in what both of us can bring to bear for a client. And if you and I and a CPA are working together, that's the power of one and one and one. So that's 111. So now we've really got some firepower. So I always tell clients, you know, work with good professionals. They're worth what you're going to pay them, because they're going to bring some terrific insight and talent to bear on your case, save you a lot of heartache, save the family a lot of heartache, and save you a lot of money in the process. I mean, it's certainly going to be an investment to do the right planning now, but what it will save the family in terms of headache later on, writing 7-8 figure checks to the government. And that's money that can be kept for the family to invest and enjoy, that sort of thing. And again, if you pay an estate tax, that's a tax on already once taxed money. Why should the government have a second bite at the apple?
Continuing the conversation on beneficiaries and the benefits that they're due, in triggering the transfer for value on a life insurance policy, can you touch on a little bit of that for a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, transfer for value, I mean, if you have an existing policy and you, transfer it into an islet, you set it up, transfer for value rules may be triggered, and so it may still be taxed to you. There are special rules that have to be observed, but if you do it the right way, usually we can get around those. And it isn't all that difficult, but, you know, we do have to go through a certain mental gymnastics to do so. And I don't want to bore the listeners, with all the morbid detail here, but just know that if you do have an existing life insurance policy and you want to transfer it into an islet, you can do that. You just have to live 3 years. But you also have to make sure you don't trigger the transfer for value rules. And again, those are very complex, but a good estate planning attorney working with your insurance professional should be able to make that a non-issue. But just know that if you do have an existing policy of insurance and you want to transfer it into a new islet you've set up or had your attorney set up, then that can happen, but we just have to be real careful we don't trigger the transfer for value rules. That would then make that taxable to you as the trust maker.
Fantastic. Okay, we're getting close to the top of the hour, so I'm going to narrow down my list. I'm going to drop just one off, so I'll be a little bit easier on you today, Rod.
Okay, thanks, sir.
Last question for you. Improper valuation of life insurance policies. I know one of the most difficult questions to answer is the question on the policy valuation. As a general rule for valuating property for tax purposes, we all basically use the fair market value.
Sure.
In your own definition, can you give us a good overview of that and definitely talk on the how it comes into bear with regards to life insurance policies?
The best way to do it is, usually we can talk to the insurance company and figure out what the if it's a whole life policy. We can usually figure out what the cash value is. And so if we're going to transfer that into a life insurance trust, then we can usually just sell it from the trust maker in his or her individual capacity to the trust and give them back a promissory note. So the cash value, usually you can establish that either through contacting the insurance company, and they can tell you what the cash value is. And, there's this term called the interpolated terminal reserve. As soon as I start saying that, people's eyes glaze over and they roll into the back of their head. So I don't want to bore the audience to tears here, but just to know that when we value the life insurance for purposes of transferring it and also doing a promissory note, there are ways that we can do that. And usually it's just a phone call to the life insurance company itself directly to find out what is the value of the whole life policy that we're going to transfer into the island. If I go much more into detail there, I'm afraid I'm going to put people to sleep, and I don't want to do that to you.
Not a problem. Well, that actually gives us a nice segue into reintroducing Rod once again. So, Rod, if you would please let the audience know your firm name and the ways they can reach you if they have any questions or concerns about their own estate planning.
Yeah, surely. This is Rod Hatley. I am an attorney in private practice here in San Diego County. My firm is the Hatley Law Group, and my web address is www.hatleylawgroup.com. That's HatleyLawGroup.com. And my phone number, should anybody want to give me a jingle, I'd be happy to speak with you. Area code 858-792-3444, 858-792-3444.
Well, fantastic, Rod. Well, I sincerely, absolutely appreciate your time this afternoon. And again,
ladies
and gentlemen, as I, in full transparency, I've known Rod for a number of years. We both have worked on a number of veteran issues down in San Diego. And again, I for my clients, depending on regions, if they're in San Diego or up here in the Inland Empire, I'll be more than happy to introduce you to, if not Rod, another attorney up here that works in estate planning, all of which are very professional, all of which can help you solve and resolve your situations. But today's guest, again, I want to give a sincere thank you to Mr. Hatley for joining us. Look forward to having you back on here fairly soon, hopefully. We can get some time out of you. Hopefully we can get you actually up to Inland Empire this time from San Diego, or maybe I'll swap places and I'll go down to San Diego for the day.
Oh, what?
All right. Well, we're going to take a real quick short commercial break, and we'll come back to close out the show. But again, this is the DRC Wealth Management Hour. I am Bobby Cherry on KCAA, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and 102.3. We will be right back.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, K292 FQ Riverside, and K293 CF Moreno Valley.
Are you thirsty for books that will fill your soul with wisdom, joy, and inspiration? Then take a refreshing and nourishing drink at Alice's Quiet Mind Bookstore, located in the heart of the Agape International Spiritual Center in Culver City, which incidentally was recently featured on The Today Show. From aromatic soy candles to best-selling authors like Dr. Michael Bernard Beckwith and a whole host of other visionaries, Alice's Quiet Mind Bookstore has everything to soothe your body, spirit, and soul. For more info and directions, visit agapelive.com today.
If you're looking for a full or part-time sales position and you have radio, TV, or print media experience, KCAA has a great opportunity waiting for you that pays the highest commissions in the market. KCAA is the only station in the IE that broadcasts on three frequencies, so advertisers receive three ads for one low rate. This makes KCAA a must-buy for every local business. If you're interested in a sales position with us, call 909-885-8502 or email ceo@kcaaradio.com.
Hi, this is Sal Tuzzolino, host and ringmaster of the Sports Circus, the big top of Sports Talk Radio. Did you hear this?
They filled a swimming pool full of Jell-O. And people could pay to watch Gary and I dive into this pool of Jell-O. And he and I raised $100,000 doing that.
That's hilarious.
Clown around with us and stream the show online at thesportscircus.com.
Join us on 1050 AM, 106.5, and 102.3 FM, Saturday mornings at 8 on the trifecta of Talkin' Sports, KCAA.
KCAA is your CNBC news affiliate. We're the station that gets down to business.
Welcome back to the DRC Wealth Management Hour with Bobby Cherry. As we close out the show, as some of you may be kind of wondering, this is our second episode of the DRC Wealth Management Hour on KCAA. A little bit of an introduction, because last weekend when we did debut, or actually last week I should say, we debuted unfortunately on the same day as another tragic shooting in San Bernardino, so we didn't have a chance to properly introduce ourselves and what we're all about. So I'd like to take just a few minutes to do that properly. Again, my name is Bobby Cherry. I am a financial advisor. I am also the president and CEO of DRC Wealth Management. It's a San Bernardino-based wealth management firm. We work with individuals and small companies in regards to their financial means. We'll be bringing on every week local and national guests to speak with you regarding wealth management and to exhibit their professionalism. As you saw today, we had an estate attorney, Mr. Rod Hatley from the Hatley Law Group out of San Diego. And last week we had Ralph and John up from Heritage West Financial. They are commodity brokers, also from San Diego. San Diego is my hometown, so I guess I am kind of biased to individuals down there for the time being. Next week we will have on CFP. His name is Bert Williamson. He's out of the Orange County area. Again, another knowledgeable expert for your listening pleasure, and help you in your decision making and as you go through your life and your financial planning and wealth management experiences. We'll be here every Monday, 3 p.m. on KCAA. We hope you join us. And again, we appreciate you joining us for this brief hour, and we look forward to seeing you again on Monday on KCAA and the DRC Wealth Management Hour with Bobby Cherry. Thank you much. The DRC Wealth Management Hour with host Bobby Cherry. Bobby Cherry is an investment advisor representative of and offers securities and investment advisory services through DRC Wealth Management Incorporated, member of FINRA and registered investment advisor. Insurance offered through Bobby Cherry, a multi-state licensed insurance agent. California insurance number 0H34723. Neither DRC Wealth Management nor its registered representatives or employees provide tax or legal advice. As with all matters of tax and legal nature, you should consult with your tax or legal counsel for advice. This show is for entertainment purposes only. No specific nor individual investment advice will be given. The conversations and opinions of this radio show are those of the guests and have not been reviewed by KCAA, DRC Wealth Management, Bobby Cherry, or any of their affiliates for completeness or accuracy.
Hi, this is Bev from Let's Go Shopping with Bev. Who loves to shop?
Me.
I do.
You do?
Yes.
I do.
Well, guess what?
What?
To hear all the fun, fabulous, and outrageous places to go for the best deals, tune in to...